In August of that year, the PLP delegation took its case to the United Nations Special Committee on Colonialism. A couple of weeks before Black Tuesday, PLP members of the House, A.D. Hanna and Milo Butler Sr., were named by the Speaker and physically carried out of the House by police officers.
In December 1966, the PLP informed the House of Commons of its intent to investigate casino gambling.
44 Januaries ago, the sparks from that one candle lit years earlier ignited, and the PLP ushered in majority rule. Although not required to call an election until November of 1967, the United Bahamian Party decided to call one on January 10th, 1967. On December 3rd, the United Bahamian Party cut off registration of voters and set the date for general election. Pindling at first, stunned by the premature election campaign, turned it to his advantage when he told the deeply religious people, "In the Bible, in the book of Exodus, the Lord said to the children of Israel that he would begin to deliver them from the Egyptians on the 10th day of the first month."
From that point on, the campaign became a religious crusade against the machinations of a wicked regime. Despite the short notice, campaigning for the 1967 general election was vigorous, determined, and intense. Posters, pennants, badges, buttons, bumper stickers, and banners added color and liveliness to the candidates' speeches. Music also played its part, a favorite song being the American Civil Rights theme, "We Shall Overcome."
Public rallies drew record crowds. The newspapers hammered on the issues. ZNS broadcast campaign speeches. It was undoubtedly the most dynamic, exciting, and memorable political experience the islands had ever lived through. The Bahamas stood on the brink of a pregnant moment in its history, while the world stood watching. The PLP slogan was, "The world is watching."
On January 9th, the Tribune headline read, 36,000 can vote tomorrow to elect 38 House members from 94 candidates, with an editorial subhead, "Which way to progress? The choice is yours." Of the 94 candidates, the UPP was sponsoring 36, the PLP 29, the NDP 13, Independents 12, and Labour 4. The UPP had occupied 24 of the 33 seats in the House of Assembly, which was dissolved on December 1, 1966.
On January 9th, the Bahamian Times, the PLP weekly newspaper, in a front page story, "The Last Chance," said, "The PLP is confident of victory in tomorrow's general elections because we believe that the majority of Bahamians are now convinced that this may be their last chance to make a political decision as a majority in their own country." The foreign press had converged on Nassau. The Bahamian Times reminded its readers that the world was watching to see whether Bahamians will return a government to power that had given the country a bad name as a haven for gangsters. PLP posters urged voters to look up and move on.
On the eve of election day, Sir Stafford Sands gave the United Bahamian Party's final election speech on ZNS radio, saying that as sure as the sun rises in the east, the United Bahamian Party would be returned as the government of the Bahamas. Finally, Tuesday, January 10th, election day dawned. The barnstorming had ceased. The PLP set up headquarters at the Reinhardt Hotel on Blue Hill Road and Tin Shop Corner. It was the people's turn to act. The Nassau Guardian, the morning's paper, reported Nassau quiet with the atmosphere sober. The polls opened and PLP supporters went to the polls singing the Exodus song, "This land is mine, God gave this land to me."
A silent horror fell over the mansions in the limestone hills. A revolution was in progress. No bullets bounced off the elegant facade of Governor Sir Ralph Gray's mansion. The work was being done with ballots, Ironically, this had been the weapon used by the Bay Street Boys to maintain power over the natives. As it appeared that the PLP was heading to victory, supporters broke out into the streets, beating goatskin drums, blowing horns and whistles to celebrate.
After the last votes were counted late that night, the results of the historical election ended in a dead heat. UPP, 18 seats. PLP, 18 seats. One independent candidate, Alvin Brannan in Harbor Island, and one Labour candidate, Randall Fox in St. Barnabas. The NDP did not win a single seat.
The PLP winners were Dr. Curtis MacMillan, Fort Charlotte, Milo Butler Sr., Bayntown, Arthur Folks, Grantstown, Cecil Wallace Whitfield, St. Agnes, Jeffrey M. Thompson, Fort Fincastle, Jimmy Shepherd, St. Michael's, Edmund Moxie, Coconut Grove, Clifford Dowling, Angleston, Uriah McPhee, Shirley, Arthur Hanna, Annstown, Carlton Francis, Winton, Dr. Elwood Donaldson, Killarney, Preston Aubrey, Eleuthera, George Thompson, Eleuthera, Warren Lavarity, Bimini and West End, Maurice Moore, Grand Bahama, Clarence Bain, Mangrove Key, Lyndon Pinling, Kemp's Bay.
Lyndon Pinling offered the independent representative, Brannan, the speakership. He accepted. The speaker had no vote, except when the House is tied. Contending forces remained 18-18. Labour leader Randall Fox was in his St. Barnabas district, listening to the plaudits of his adherents, when, so he says, Premier Simonet himself paid him a personal visit.
Sir Roland Simonet was accustomed to having people come to him. He knew, and so did Fox, that the revolution hinged on a solitary vote. If Bay Street Boys could bring Randall Fox to their side, at any price, Pinling and his colored government was still born. Name your terms, the premier said. Whatever it is, we will meet it.
Fox could name his terms to the premier of Her Majesty's government. Would he ask $1 million or $500,000 and a ministry? The Negro said he was sorry. He had decided to go along with Pinling. He had no terms, no price. It was incredible. The answer was no.
This gave Pinling a speaker and a 1918 majority in the House. Sir Roland and his government resigned. That night, people danced in the streets. Black tie dinners in the Bahamian Club on West Bay Street and Buena Vista on Delancey Hill sipped expensive soups absentmindedly. Their world had come to an end.
The PLP had won 10 new seats and retained 2 old seats in New Providence. In the Out Islands, the PLP won 4 new seats and retained 2 old seats.
On January 11th, leader Lyndon Pinling flew back from Andrews, where he was met at the airport by several hundred supporters, including Bahamian film star Sidney Poitier. Pinling was hoisted onto their shoulders and carried to his limousine before awaiting international TV cameras. Before the victory motorcade began, Pinling told reporters, "We will all get a fair share from now on." On January 12th, the Tribune reported an informal meeting between Pinling and the governor, Sir Ralph Grey, to discuss the constitutional situation resulting from the election. Pinling told the press he had no doubt that they would have little difficulty in forming a new government. Asked about the possibility of a coalition government with the UPP, he replied,
"No such chance."
On Saturday, January 14th, Pinling was officially invited to Government House by the governor to form a new government. A statement from Government House said that the governor, in exercise of his responsibility under the Constitution, has concluded that Mr. Pinling is a member of the House of Assembly who is best able to command the confidence of the majority of the members of the chamber and who is willing to accept the office of premier. Sir Roland Simon had informed the governor that he was no longer able to command the support of the majority of the House members and was therefore resigning his office. Under the new administration, Sir Roland Simon would become leader of the opposition.
While much of the PLP history is chronicled in books, articles, pamphlets, and magazines, the true movement lies in the faces. The diverse multiracial army of ordinary women and men from every walk of life, race, and class united to awaken the consciousness of a people and a nation. The PLP will remain vigilant in its mission until the promise of the Bahamas is made real for all Bahamians.
Thus it was on the 10th day of the first month that black Bahamians emerged from the centuries-old domination of a white group and crossed over to the promised land of milk and honey, on which they could grow more and more, able to shape their own destiny. They could walk tall and proud in their own land as never before, and humble too, as their deeply religious sense attributed their glory and victory to the mysterious ways of their God.
Ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand and walk this land with me, and walk.